Hi, I'm Bill Kleitz. The material that I'll be covering in this podcast is out of my Digital Electronics 9th edition textbook. I hope you find it useful.
Hi, this is Professor Kleitz. In section 1511, we're going to tie it all together by looking at a data acquisition system application. The computerized acquisition of analog quantities is becoming more important than ever in today's automated world. Computer systems are capable of scanning several analog inputs on a particular schedule and sequence to monitor critical quantities and acquire data for future recall. A typical 8-channel computerized data acquisition system is shown in the next diagram. So in the top part of the diagram, we have all the analog transducers that are feeding into a multiplexer switch, and then a sample and hold circuit, a programmable gain instrumentation amp, and then that's fed into the microprocessor system, which has an A to D converter connected to a data bus, which is connected to a microcontroller. So let's start up at the top. The transducers we're looking at, like I said before, the world is analog, and these are some of the analog values you may want to be able to look at in an automated system. First of all, temperature. That varies in an analog scale, and that's going to be set up to output a voltage that's dependent on temperature. And then here's a pressure transducer. Displacement, that would be movement. Is something been moved to the left or to the right? At what speed? Well, speed would be the velocity sensor. Some sort of a fluid level. Is it getting close to its limits? And if you're filling up a tank or whatever, kilowatts, that would be the volts times amps, the amount of energy that's being consumed. Humidity sensor, solar radiation. So here's our 8 analog sensors. A multiplexer is a type of device that will select one of these inputs and send it across. So the 1 of 8 select comes in off of the control bus, which is driven by the microprocessor or microcontroller. So if you set up this as 000, you would end up reading the temperature. Now that temperature value, analog voltage, is being sent across to a sample and hold circuit, which has a hold capacitor on it. There's an acquisition trigger that is sent into this device, and at that instant, whatever the analog value is, it's grabbed, put on the hold capacitor, and then if the value changes, it's too late, it's already been acquired. Okay, so this gives you a real specific time period in which you acquire the data. That value has to be conditioned. Usually it's going to be increased in value. So some of these values coming across are going to be millivolts, some may be volts. We have a programmable gain instrumentation amp, the LH0084, which has a gain select on it. And if it's 00, the gain would be one value. If it's 01, another, and all the way up to 11. So you have 4 choices of gain. So here's the adjusted Vout, which is going to get increased to a size high enough for the A to D converter to recognize in a good scale setting. So this analog value comes in, and it's probably going to be in the range of 1 or 2 volts or something like that. If this is set up as a 0 to 5 A to D, this analog value, the idea is it's going to be converted into a digital string and sent to a data bus where the microprocessor, microcontroller, can read it into port 0. Now the microcontroller has a control bus. It's got several signals on it, including the 1 of 8 data select, as well as the chip select, the read, the write, the interrupt, and the chip select for the memory, and then the read write for the memory. So first of all, we want to look at the data that's coming through the A to D, so we have to do a chip select on an A to D converter, and then we do a write pulse. Now this is the start convert, the WR. We studied this in the last section. After the write pulse, the microcontroller will pull the interrupt line, and it keeps looking at the interrupt line over and over again, and it's waiting for it to go low. As soon as this goes low, that means that the A to D is done. As soon as the A to D is done, it has its values on the D lines. That's when the microcontroller issues the read command, which is the output enable. And as soon as that happens, these outputs are enabled and they dump their information over to the data bus. So after the microcontroller issues that write command, it waits some specified time, usually in a couple microseconds, for the data to be ready on the data bus, and then it grabs the data, brings it into the microprocessor port. It operates on that information and stores that data value into a RAM memory. And then the microprocessor issues a command to go to a different data select. So maybe it increments these lines to 001, picks up another data item, that data item comes down through, and it goes through the process all over again and stores that data item. Now it may be doing a timestamp at the same time. What time of day did it take that reading? And in the RAM memory, it puts the time that it read it, which sensor it read, and what the value of the sensor was. So as you can see, the microcontroller has control over bringing in all these analog values and then converting them into a digital string and storing them for later recall by the engineer who wants to look at these data values. So now let's spend a couple minutes looking at some of the transducers and signal conditioning that I was talking about in the previous section. Hundreds of transducers are available today that convert physical quantities such as heat, light, or force into electrical quantities. The electrical quantities or signal levels must then be conditioned or modified before they can be interpreted by a digital computer. So the first sensor we'll look at is a thermistor. This is an electronic component whose resistance is highly dependent on temperature. Its resistance changes by several percent with each degree change in temperature. It's a very sensitive temperature sensing device. One problem, however, is that its response is nonlinear, meaning that 1 degree step changes in temperature will not create equal step changes in resistance. This fact is illustrated in the characteristic curve of the 10K ohm at 25 degrees C thermistor shown below. And you can see that as the temperature increases, the resistance drops, but it's not a straight line, it's a nonlinear function. The manufacturer of thermistors will give you the XY equation for this curve, and you could plug that into a microprocessor to determine exactly at what temperature you'll get what resistance, or vice versa. A simple circuit that can be used to convert a thermistor resistance into a DC voltage is this op-amp circuit shown in figure 22. I set up a voltage of minus 250 millivolts. This is a reference voltage that we placed right here. And if you know this voltage and you know the RF-RI combination, the equation that we derived earlier in the chapter for Vout is you take the EN times the negative times the ratio of the RF over RI, and this voltage right here will be sent into the input of an ADC. Now if you look at a chart from the manufacturer, you'll be able to determine what the resistance is at various temperatures. And I looked it up, and at 0 degrees C, the resistance is 29.49K, and all the rest of these values follow from the data chart in the manufacturer's data sheet. Now if you know this value, you could go back to the previous diagram and add that to the 10K that's in series with the thermistor for a total of these resistances, and then you apply this in the equation to calculate what the output voltage would be. So now what we have is for 0 degrees C, the output voltage is 1.27, for 25 degrees C is 2.5, and so on. We could use these values here such that when we read the analog value and store it in the microcontroller, if we look up and we see that it was 2.5 volts, then we know it was 25 degrees C, and so on. So there are linear IC temperature sensors, and the deal is that the computer software required to convert the output voltages in the previous thermistor circuit is fairly complicated because of the nonlinear characteristics of the device. Linear temperature sensors were developed to simplify the procedure. One such device is the LM35, and there's also the LM34 IC temperature sensors. Let's take a look at those. So in this figure, we're going to interface the LM35, which outputs 0 millivolts plus 10 millivolts for every degree C. So if it's 20 degrees C, for example, this would be 20 times this, which would be 200 millivolts you would be feeling right here at the VN. We set up a precision voltage reference that outputs 1.28 volts using a precision Zener diode and a potentiometer. Now, if this is 1.28 volts at the VREF over 2, this makes VREF equal to 2.56 volts, which is 2,560 millivolts. And as you read in the textbook, this corresponds to a 1-bit change for every 1 degree centigrade. And I go through that math in the textbook. So if it's 1 degree C, you'll get the number 1. If it's 2 degrees C, you'll get the D1 bit on, which is the number 2. If it's 3, you would get these 2 on, and so on. This makes the math real simple in the 8051 microcontroller. When it reads the port, it knows exactly what the temperature is bit by bit in degrees C. We have the handshaking control on port 1, where we start convert and we wait for the end convert. When the end convert comes along, we do the output enable, which dumps the data values into the port. And in table 15.3, we look at a tabulation of the temperature versus the binary values. So as the temperature steps up, for example, if it's 1 degree C, we'll get a binary value 1. If it's 2 degrees C, the VIN would have been 20 millivolts. That gives you the number 2. If it's 25 degrees C and so on, you get the number 25. There we got the 16-bit, the 8 plus the 1, and so on up through. This is real nice and convenient because the binary value is exactly convertible into the actual degree C in temperature. And the last analog sensor I want to talk about is a strain gauge. It's a device whose resistance changes when it's stretched. The gauge is stretched or elongated when it is strained by a physical force, usually a weight of some sort. This property makes it useful for measuring weight, pressure, flow, and acceleration. Now, here's a photograph of the strain gauge, and the sensitivity axis is back and forth in this direction, as shown in this diagram. Now, if this is mounted on a piece of metal and you flex this metal, the pieces of wire, which are very thin, will be stretched in this direction, changing the resistance of the strain gauge. Typical strain gauges will be about 120 ohms from tab to tab, and when you stretch it, it may go out to 120.1 ohms or whatever. So we have to have some signal conditioning to change this small change in resistance into a voltage, and that's what we'll look at in the next diagram. But first, in figure 25, we'll look at, here we have an anchor block, a piece of metal. Like I said, we're going to put the force here, and we're going to have the original resistance, which might be 120 ohms, plus some new added resistance based on what the force is. This is called a bridge circuit, and we set it up with all 120 ohm resistances. Sometimes we'll actually use 4 strain gauges because they're all 120 ohms, and put 3 of them in the non-sensitivity axis and use just 1 in the sensitivity axis, and that would be this one right here. As you add the weight, this resistance increases in the bridge circuit. You take the small change in voltage that you'll feel at point A relative to point B, you feed it into an instrumentation amplifier with a high gain, and you'll get a high voltage out. This voltage out can be calculated using the following equation. Equation 15-9 looks a little complicated, but it's really not that bad. So you have the voltage at A to B is equal to whatever the input excitation voltage was times the series of resistance calculations and subtractions. And so if we were, for example, at 120 ohms, and when you added the weight, you got 150 milliohms of change, here's the calculation you would use, and you'd get 3.12 millivolts out at point A to B. But that goes into an instrumentation amp with a gain of 1,000, so you'd end up with a voltage of about 3.12 volts going into the ADC for that particular strain. So I hope this section helped you understand and see the uses of analog transducers as applied to a complete data acquisition system. The next chapter, that completes this chapter actually, so the next chapter we're going to talk about memory that's used in microprocessor and computer systems, whether it be semiconductor, magnetic, or optical memory.